Well, the troubles I've had to get this recording going again is just tremendous. But it's all the grace of God. I was blocked for a while, and it was necessary. So it was great. I was doing a project I needed to do, and so I was just not able to. The technology, electronics would not work properly. Everything was blocked, 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 blocked. Finally, it's unblocked here. So it's great. Just go with the flow. If something's blocked, just thank God and say, okay, that's for a great reason. You see if I get my voice going. Ah, wow, how's everyone? I'm doing fabulous, tremendous, tremendous. Better than ever. Realizing, of course, that words are insufficient to express it. It's a time of action right now, big time of action. You need to be in an action groove. Words, everyone's in an action groove right now, actually. So words really, people are not receptive to words, and words actually kind of cloud everything. Clarity gets clouded by words, unless there's even the best wordsmiths, it's still a little bit cloudy. So here, we don't try to explain too much, except point to the basics, which are very simple, and then advise everyone. It's advice here. It's clear advice that steady determination is the only way. Without steady determination, no matter how you label what you're doing, you won't succeed. You won't succeed. So steady determination is the path. So you want to do everything you can to keep keep your path steady. You don't want it to be too erratic. You'll quit if it's too erratic. It seems too tumultuous and frightening. So I've been able to smooth out my path through following right advice of the Dharma kings and the Holy Spirit. And I keep working to make it smooth. I work on my path constantly. It's not like I take it easy. No, just the opposite. I'm working, more diligently than ever. Especially now, wowing my day all day long. It's just one continuous wow, basically. So the basics are is that really the only problem we have is continuity fear. We don't have any other problem. I've said this 1,000 times. Say it 10,000 more times, and then 1,000,000 more times. It's the only truth that we need to grab a hold on as far as our problems go. We have a continuity fear problem, lack of familiarity. We're familiar with doubt. Okay, there's no doubt in reality, not a trace of doubt. But we are super familiar with doubt, but really we're pretending doubt, but we're still familiar with our pretense of doubt. Okay, we are familiar with that, and so we're biased towards that, and we're super biased against no doubt, against certitude, super biased. And since it's a familiarity problem, no amount of analysis is going to unravel that bias. We can recognize that we're biased through analysis, yes, but we can't undo the bias through analysis. So that's why many stall out on the path of analysis, they stall out. We don't want to stall out. So there has to be something that takes us beyond analysis, but we're frightened to tackle the familiarity issue. It's very frightening, isn't it? It's the guts of our problem. We're right into it. So, but we have the way to do this. So that's why instead of analysis, I advise we practice full stop in the wow, blocking the panic that arises when we start to deal with the issue of familiarity. It's bound to panic us because we're so biased against, like, let's say paradise. Did you know that we're totally biased against paradise, for instance? Totally biased against it. Or let's say extremely biased against it. So how do we overcome this bias? Right. By little glimpses, and then blocking the panic. Little glimpses, blocking the panic. Little glimpses, blocking the panic. This is the path. That's why it requires steady determination. You can't just say, oh, analyze it. Like I'm telling somebody, you need to exercise, exercise, and do. They say, what? I say, do this, 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 like physical exercise. And they say, oh, okay, I got it. Then do they exercise? No. They say, no. And I say, why don't you exercise? Well, I understood what you told me. You told me that I needed to exercise and this, and I understood it. Understood it conceptually, in an analytical way. But where is the familiarity issue being tackled? In other words, actually starting to do it. It never happens. And then they have to try to justify this by saying that I must be crazy, because why would I ask them to actually do it? Well, because we have a severe bias problem that's causing us all our suffering. And then, of course, they say, well, we can learn to love our bias, doubt. We can learn to love doubt. And I say, no, you can't. And what we think is mental illness is the way to love doubt. Okay, so when we don't practice steady determination, a full stop in the wow, to getting familiar with reality, we're headed towards mental illness. There's no other path to take. We keep thinking there's some other path to take between certitude and incertitude is insanity. It's relying on insanity to make us happy with doubt. It's exactly what it's doing. So for me, I wondered, how could I fall down into such bad mental health previously? I said that I'm so intelligent. How could that happen? Well, because exactly what I've just said. The world here insisted, no, the way to help us is to help us be happy with doubt. But the only pathway there is to do that is mental illness, mental conflict, to have mental conflict be constant. Severe and constant, as if we could get used to it, totally used to it, familiar with mental conflict, then we're going to be blissfully happy with that. But that's a false corollary. Getting familiar with reality, it's not the familiarity that makes us happy. It's reality that makes us happy. So familiarity is a bridge. It's not the place itself. It's not, okay, so we need to cross this bridge using the issue of familiarity. But once we're across the bridge, it's reality that makes us happy. Got it? So you can't say, well, I'm familiar with mental chaos, therefore I should be happy with it. Because you're leaving out, what are you familiar with? And then from that bridge, you have to then abide. So what I discovered was you cannot abide in total mental chaos. It's impossible. Because it's a picture of non-abidance, actually. It's the desire for non-abidance taken to the extreme. So it's futile. So familiarity is a bridge. It's a bridge, obviously. And yet our continuity fear blinds us to what is so obvious, right? So recently my clarity is rising more and more and more and more and more. And yesterday was just tremendous, tremendous, feisty all day in terms of adamant clarity. It was just the best ever. So I thank God for that. Thank the grace of God. But to keep this near certitude, which is where I was at, and what I'm very close to is near. I'm in near certitude. I have near certitude, but that's not the same as certitude. I'm still on the bridge. Okay, so that's a dangerous situation right now, because the world is out to destroy certitude, and since they can't really get to certitude, then they go after near certitude, which is why Jesus told us in the end of days, even the saints would be in danger of being pulled down, meaning those of near certitude. Near certitude. A great saint has certitude. That's very rare here. Very rare. But it's certainly possible. It is certainly possible. However, most of us, realistically, in assessing the world, what I see, your goal should be near certitude. You should get near to certitude, really near to it, but like 99.9%. Okay, aim for that. That's a realistic goal. However, then you need to be protected from what's going to happen in the world. This has been pointed out to me very, very severely, and it's just like, wow, okay, great. Thank you for the protection. I was in a situation yesterday that is pretty difficult to describe or believe, but it took place. It was so surreal that, you know, you're just going to shake your head and say, wow, wow. Wow. I was at a place. I got put into this place yesterday. I was working, and I had to go to this place. And there are these three huge dogs that are rather vicious, gigantic dogs, 160-pound type of dogs. Okay, and we know that they're very aggressive. One of them jumped at my throat one time, and that one of them, and the same one bit somebody badly there before. And then so the dog handler lady is there, and we're discussing it. She says, "Oh," she said, "no, she's a sweetheart. She's fine." I said, "Well, she did this, this." She goes, "Yeah. She gives a bad name to other dogs, all female dogs." She says, "She gives a bad name. She's that." So first she tried to pass her off as being perfectly harmless, and then she said, "Well, yeah, she's pretty terrible." So she knew that I knew that this dog's terrible. And my friend was there too, and I told him, and he almost got attacked by him when he went to the door. He was real scared. And I said, "Look out for these dogs. They're not friendly dogs at all. They're very protective and aggressive, and huge, and not afraid to go lunge at a person. You know, that big." So we're down in this room, downstairs in this room. No way out, actually. And they're upstairs with the dogs, the owner and the dog handling lady. And there's this door that prevents them from going down the stairs. And they're blocking the dogs and making sure they don't come down, all right? Because they know we're working there, and these dogs are a menace, okay? A menace. I mean, they could get sued, right? They should be if the dog tries to bite somebody. And at least theoretically, I don't sue anybody because everything's our own choice, right? So what happened was, I was down there, we're down there, and we were working with some equipment, some huge, big piece of equipment in this room. And this equipment was kind of in the corner of the room. It was like about 4 feet tall by 3 feet wide, you know, by 2 feet in depth. You know, it was a big piece of equipment, burly, heavy, real heavy. Suddenly, they let the dogs down. They let the dogs down. Okay, they open the door. They let the dogs out, knowing that the dogs were barking, wanting to go down there and intimidate us. They open the door. These two ladies, two women, open the door and let the dogs loose on us. Okay, because they knew we were there. We were talking with them. They were absolutely, you know, making sure the dogs wouldn't come down, which is their job. And then they simply, I mean, there's a dog handling lady. She's an expert in all this. Okay, there's no excuse at all. They let the dogs come down on purpose, of course. There's no accidents. That was on purpose to intimidate the heck out of us. Okay, and now my friend, who's very strong and agile, but he panicked. And he was just shouting and jumping, and he was just in a state of great emotional, you know, fear. But I was back in the room with the equipment right there, and what I did was I just quickly moved behind the equipment, so the equipment was between me and the dogs in the corner, and I said they can't get at me. The dogs came in there, they're looking to see how can I get at them, but I took retreat behind this barrier, and they couldn't really get to me, you know. So they could see that I was in a safe place, and they were rah, rah, you know, roaring at me, making a huge commotion to try to intimidate. But I stayed extremely calm. Not my heartbeat didn't pulse didn't change in the slightest bit. But my friend was just absolutely beside himself with emotional commotion, yelling and yelling. I was just quiet, calm, didn't move. I just said, "Okay, dogs, I'm just gonna stay right here. You can't get to me. I'll block you. You're blocked." Finally, and the women kept calling the dogs. The dogs didn't respond because they weren't doing it strong enough. And I noticed that. So the whole thing, ultimately, finally, they got the dogs upstairs again, after they had tried caused, you know, massive intimidation on us. So I just noticed all this very calmly. As I just noticed, okay, wow, this is God showing me something. And finally, we got out of there. And they're saying, "Oh, sorry, sorry, sorry." That's the Silicon Valley thing. Sorry, everything's sorry. Someone like almost kills you in a car, you know, or something. Sorry. We're gonna have to flip that one, aren't we? Flip that script. Are you sorry or are you wrong? Okay. Right? No, wrong, mistaken, non-dharmic. You're not sorry, you're non-dharmic. Something like that. We'll see what we can, how we can flip that one. But I came out of there, and to this day, as I was yesterday, completely calm, not even a tremor of nerves. Completely calm. Because I was safe. I knew I was safe. So not the slightest bit of freak out. No freak out. I just said, okay, how can I be safe? Oh, this is it. Do it. I did it. Oh, no problem. No problem. Meanwhile, these 500 pounds of raging dogs were raging all about, right? Causing massive commotion. Bellowing and like they were, out for blood, and didn't affect me in the slightest bit. Because I was safe. So this is God's grace showing me, taking refuge in a place of safety right now will protect us from the dogs, the violent turmoil that is to come, the tremendous emotional, the emotionalism that's going to be unleashed in the world, the emotionalism. And it was the women that unleashed it, for sure. This is what I've been saying for my whole life. It's the women who are going to unleash the emotionalism upon the world. And they're going to say to the dogs, go get them. And the men are like the dogs. Okay. But it's the women that tell the dogs, okay, this is what we want. They purposefully sent the dogs down there. It says, scare the hell out of those guys. Okay. So why? So we can be easily controlled. Right? Because when you're in a panic state, then you easily lose sight of certitude. Panic means you're not certain what to do. But for me, I was certain I was safe, and so I didn't lose my state of certitude that I'd had all day long. I had this tremendous run of certitude, the best I've ever had in my and ever. And then the women try to use those dogs to try and destroy my certitude. You see, that get me to panic. And I didn't panic at all. And later on, I spoke with one of them. I never spoke with them before. And they were kind of like sesame, like, huh, I wonder, he didn't doesn't seem to be too messed up. I wonder if that worked or not. That's how diabolical the mind is that believes in managing conflict. See, what we're trying to do is worship doubt, deify doubt, okay? Deify doubt. And this creates conflict, imaginary conflict. It's imaginary, yes, but it seems quite real to us, of conflict in the mind, thinking the mind is somehow split between one mind and another mind, as if the mind can create another mind, and it cannot. It cannot. There's so the attempt to deify doubt and be happy with doubt. There's two different kind of basic ways. One is to triumph over conflict, have a decisive victory, like one side of the conflict defeats the other side of the conflict. Okay, that's general what we call male energy is to try to defeat the conflict, and the other way is to manage the conflict, which is more female energy. So those are two sides of the same coin of trying to, deify doubt, trying to deify doubt. Trying to be happy with doubt. How can we be happy with doubt? Well, let's destroy the unhappiness, or let's manage the unhappiness. So the male energy is out to destroy the unhappiness, and the female energy is out to manage the unhappiness. Okay, and manage it. So that's why there's sort of this stylistic difference. But those are two sides of the exact same coin of trying to be happy with conflict. And we're neither male nor female. We're spirit. Male and female, those energies, dynamics, are just our own defensive system of our attempt, our belief system of trying to be, learn to be happy with doubt, somehow to be happy with doubt. And the female says, you can learn to do it. We can manage it. You can learn how to do it. We have a, and the men says, no, we need to defeat, there's some enemy there. We need to defeat the unhappiness somewhere. Let's find this unhappiness and defeat it. Of course, neither way has any possibility of working whatsoever. So here we are with our attention on this, on two different styles of trying to do the impossible, that's not dharmic. Okay, that's called non-dharmic, non-dharmic, non-dharmic. This blue thing is a heat pad that I'm putting on my back to keep myself warm out here because it's so cold outside. It's very chilly in the shade here because it's so much moisture in the air from all the rain. And this is helping out a lot. So that's non-dharmic culture. To have your attention on conflict and trying to find some way to be happy with it instead of letting go of conflict, which we're biased towards against doing that. We're super biased against doing that due to familiarity problem. We keep thinking, no, there must be a way. There's no way. Reality, there's no doubt in God. There's no doubt in reality, not a trace. Never will be. No doubt at all. There's no conflict. No doubt. To say that lies and truth can both be true, the only is a conflict in the mind. Obviously, it's a potential conflict, and the mind then imagines what can it do with this potential conflict. But there's really never any conflict in the mind, actually, none. But we're imagining, well, potentially, if truth and lies were both true, then how would that be? Well, it'd be a conflict. So we're playing out this imaginary conflict, actually, but it seems, you know, very real to us. Attention on managing or triumphing over something to gain happiness with conflict, that's non-dharmic. Okay, no matter how you label it, it's non-dharmic. It's not the way at all. So special relationships, men and women, they say, well, if we could just sort of blend our two styles, or usually it's the women say, I could teach you how to, yeah, your way doesn't work, but don't worry, my way works. I can help you manage the conflict and learn to live with the conflict, the art of living with the conflict, you know. This is their style. And of course, this is, you know, totally non-dharmic, totally. So this has to be seen, And we have to abandon the male and the female and male strategies that we've been using and go to a dharmic strategy, which is full stop in the wow, steady determination, full stop in the wow, of which blocks the panic from glimpsing truth. No conflict. No conflict. Seeing no conflict. Not conflict resolved, but no conflict. There's never been any conflict in reality at all. We're imagining a conflict, okay? There's no conflict. There's no conflict in truth at all. Our minds are not split. Our minds are not in conflict. We're imagining a scenario of conflict. We're pretending to be in conflict. But pretense is not established, is not factual. So we're pretending we're in conflict. That doesn't mean we're in conflict. It does not mean we're in conflict. It's meaningless, really. Pretense is meaningless. Pretense is meaningless. Now, it's always meaningless ultimately, but we can give it a different usage. It's still meaningless, but it can be pragmatically useful and pretend to not be in conflict. Okay, we could pretend to not be in conflict, right? So we still are pretending, but we're now pretending to not be in conflict. Wow, I'm already no conflict. Already no conflict. And we don't answer where it went. We just say, wow. Because obviously, it's just pretending. Where does it go? What do you mean, where does pretending go? It was never factual in the first place. So there's nowhere it can go. We just stop pretending. So already stop pretending. No conflict. Wow. There's nothing we need to track down. It's traceless. The ending of pretense is traceless, right? There's nothing leaving any trace anywhere. How could there be? So there's no conflict in reality at all. No conflict in our mind. Everything's perfect. And when we glimpse this, we're so biased against it that we, our bias starts, kicks up. Obviously, it'll kick up. In Christianity, it says we're all sinners. A clearer way of saying this, or a way that is maybe resonates better with us right now, maybe that resonated with them beautifully when it was said, but resonates with us right now, is we're biased. We're very biased. We have a familiarity bias. There's no way around it. So those who say, well, I don't want to be biased, so I'll just conceptually say, oh, I get it, I understand it, so I'm not biased anymore. The bias is one of familiarity, not of analytical mistake. So just saying you got it by listening to this is ridiculous. If you get it, you'll start practicing. If you don't practice, then you don't get it, for sure. It's the same with everyone. I'm biased. Everyone's biased here. Only the Dharma kings are not biased. Everyone else is biased. We wouldn't be here unless we had severe bias. It goes for everyone. Even the gurus, they should be humble and say that they're still biased. I mean, the ones here in the world, you know, the ones that are popular, everything, they should be humble and say, look, I'm still biased. I'm still biased. There's still some bias, okay? And be humble, and they say, I'm still working on my remaining bias. Because if they weren't, they'd be a Dharma king. And I don't see Dharma kings here, really. Okay, I really don't see Dharma kings. Maybe there's some, okay? So if people think they are, I'm not going to argue with them. But in general, really, for you, for everyone listening, you have to really accept you're very biased. Okay, we're all very biased against reality. Very biased in terms of familiarity. Familiarity casts the shadow of bias. Okay? It absolutely does. But the corollary only goes in one direction. We could be familiarity with delusion biases us against reality. But familiarity with reality is not a bias towards reality, because reality is all there is. So how can there be said to be a bias towards it? Because bias implies two-ness, right? It implies two-ness. There's nothing really to be biased against, ultimately. But because we're familiar with thinking our imagination is factual, pragmatically, we need to understand we're extremely biased against reality. Frightened, not familiar, feeling lack of familiarity. So every time I've glimpsed clarity of the truth, I realize, okay, my bias is going to be in play here. So I better block the panic that this bias is going to try and stir up. What does bias do? It tries to stir up doubt. How does doubt get stirred up? Through panic. Oh, I don't know how to label this. I don't know what to do with this. I don't know. Stirs up panic. And then you go back into doubts and start trying to worship doubts, fixate on doubts and idolize doubt in some beautiful form, some idol form. Okay, we make idols to help us worship doubt. People can make it. You can make an idol out of anything. You can make an idol out of Jesus if you want to, or Virgin Mary if you want to, and say, oh no, the Jesus excuses me from reality, or the Virgin Mary excuses me from Jesus, who doesn't excuse me from reality, or she excuses me from reality, on and on and on, right? We make these, we imagine, we're biased. Now, that doesn't mean Jesus didn't give us the right advice. He has, but we're biased against right advice. You see, so our bias makes imaginary idols and puts stuffs words in their mouth and says, Jesus wants to tells me that I can be excused from reality. You know, his death excused me from reality. No, it didn't. There's no excusing from reality, because that's all there is. There's nowhere to be excused to. There's nowhere to be excused to. So you see that steady determination is required here to overcome this bias. We have no choice at all. No choice. The path starts when you realize you have no choice. And right now, the world is not in the mood to listen to this message that I'm giving. It's obvious to me. It's been pointed out to me over and over again. The bias is kicking in really strongly now because of technology and materialism. And the election of Trump is causing people to have this mood swing towards, hey, we can learn to be happy with materialism. Materialism can make us happy. And if it was Clinton, it would be mental illness can make us happy. We can learn to manage mental illness, manage conflict. So there's two different styles. Hillary Clinton was the liberal style. Is we can learn to manage conflict properly. Okay, which is totally untrue. And then the more conservative Trump style of we can defeat the enemies of happiness, the enemies of materiality, defeat, you know, the enemies of prosperity, and we'll be so prosperous that we'll be happy. Right, that the problem is just that we're not rich enough. Okay, we don't have enough power. We need more power over what? Over nature. Both are completely deluded. All right, both are total delusion. Nothing more than that. So now there's this huge fervor, which will go in different directions, and the dogs of turmoil are about to be unleashed upon us. These ferocious dogs are about to be unleashed, which is what happened, literally happened to me yesterday. It was like they unleashed the dogs. They had the dogs totally blocked, and they decided to unleash them to terrorize us. It's exactly what it was. It was an act of terrorism, actually, on their part. Are you kidding? You have three huge, vicious dogs like that. That whether they're going to bite you or not, they're extremely intimidating, who are like fired up with protectivism going after you, unleashing them upon guys who are in a trap situation with no escape. That's terrorism. So they were terrorists, no question about it. No question about it. You don't think women can be terrorists? They absolutely can. Big time. They're the ones really behind terrorism. They unleash the thugs to cause the world to be all this commotion, and then they can come on the scene and say, "Look, boys, we know how to manage this commotion. You know, we can manage conflict. We're conflict management experts." That's how they think. Okay, some, right? Those who are dharmic can understand what I'm saying. Because I'm speaking from the dharmic viewpoint, and which means those are dharmic means realize they're spirit. They're not genders or physical entities or anything like that. We're mind. And we don't want to identify with either male or female roles or dynamics, or any combination thereof. We're dharmic. Okay, and so we practice skillful means is what we do. We practice skillful means. That's dharma. If you don't practice skillful means, you're not dharmic. You might be probationary dharmic, working up towards that, yes. So there is this in Buddhism it's called a stream enterers. Or first you get near the stream, I would say, and you watch the stream. Those are probationaries. They're considering, huh? I'd like to enter that stream. I think I need to enter that stream. I have no choice to enter that stream, but I'm not quite ready to enter it. And then you get those who are kind of entering the stream. Those who have entered the stream, you might say, are dharmic. And then there are those who are there, and they say, well, I know I have to, but I'm not quite ready, but I'm preparing my readiness by paying attention to those, you know, the dharma. Those are, you know, they're apprentices, like apprentice dharmic apprentices. They're not really yet dharmic. Because to be dharmic, you have to practice skillful means. Because once you're in the river, you have to practice skillful means to quote-unquote, get across. Ultimately, you realize there is no river. It's all just a dream. But like a bridge, getting across is the river is the river of bias, actually. Okay, it's the river of continuity, fear, and bias. So there is this river of continuity, fear, and bias, and we have to cross that. We have to evaporate it, really. We have to evaporate it. The crossing of it means that it loses its the current. The current gets less and less and less and less and less. As we use skillful means, the current bothers us less and less and less and less. Until ultimately the current is just a tiny little trickle, near certitude. Then you're what's called a Dharma prince has near certitude. But not still complete certitude. No. So there's still a trickle of continuity fear. There's a trickle, a little stream of water, but it's not this raging torrent. So when you start the Dharma, there's this raging river, and you say, there's no way I can cross that. And yet some have done so, and you think, how do they do that? Well, it's really an issue of not so much crossing, that's just a metaphor. As Buddha said, the wise are already on the other side. They're already on the other side. It's right recognition begins this calming of the current. Okay, right recognition begins this calming of the current. So entering it really means you're engaging your mind, your attention is on this raging torrent, and you say, I have to abide where this torrent is. I must abide. Okay. Therefore, how do I stop this torrent? How do I calm this torrent down? And evaporating your continuity fear, stay determination evaporates the continuity fear, and that's what the torrent really is. You don't have to really cross it. Once it's calmed and there's a trickle, you're close to realizing it was just my bias towards reality. There's no conflict in reality at all. And then when that's seen, you realize there isn't any torrent anywhere. There's no stream of bias anywhere. None. There's no bias. God has no bias. There's only reality. What could God be biased towards? If there's just one, where could there be bias? If there's just one, where could there be bias? It's a miracle this is all working. I don't even know if it's going through two channels of audio. I have a real problem. I guess it is. That's terrific. Okay. Now, special relationships are a big problem, and generally, it's each one will go into a special relationship. Generally, it's two different styles. One is to say I can overcome the conflict, and the other says I can learn to manage it. Generally, it's male and female energies there, depending on generally it plays out that the women are a certain way, the men are the other way, but it can be variations on that, of course. From a Dharmic standpoint, we recognize that. We also recognize the importance of speaking in generalities to give an overall, clarity to the whole situation, not clouding it up with too many details. And so the women said, "Oh, I need help. I need to work on my skills of managing conflict, but I need a man so I can practice on him." That's what I've recognize in the world, is women are simply using men to practice on them, to practice their skills of managing conflict. And so they want the man to be kind of like a certain way so they can say, okay, here's the conflict, now I get to work on managing it. Oh, goody. Whereas the man is trying to get a specific outcome, like a defeat, something has to be gotten rid of. So he tries to tell the woman, look, you need to do this way, this and this, do this and this will work. And so he's working on trying to convince someone that, this is victory. This is a triumph. So then there's this conflict in the relationship, of course. Different styles. Of course, neither one of them has any possibility of working at all. So as the troubles in the world arise, as the dogs of hell are unleashed upon us, which is going to happen very soon, the women will make their move. These were very non-dharmic women, actually. Very much so. Okay, very reptilian types. They're going to unleash turmoil upon the world, and the men and the women are going to jump into special relationships, because they see, I really need to improve upon my dealing with conflict. Okay, that's non-dharmic. We don't deal with conflict. We evaporate our continuity fear towards seeing there is no conflict. There's never been any conflict. There's never been any conflict at all. Everything has always been perfect, just as it is. It's always perfect. Everything appears as perfection, abides as perfection, subsides as perfection, and there's nothing else. And the problem of the special relationship is each one tries to convince the other that they're very willing to be a willing pupil of the other. Okay? The woman tries to convince the man, like, oh, I'm very good at taking orders and helping go in a certain direction and succeeding and defeating. Look, I've learned all the language of doing that. But her purpose is to really, that's just a front, and her real purpose is to manage conflict, learn to be a better manager of conflict. And the man will pretend like he's very conciliatory about, yeah, I know I need to be a better, I need to learn to manage my conflict better, yes. And he's all, you know, he's taken all these classes too of how to be more nice, more tolerant, better in a relationship. You know, he's a contrite male, you know, that kind of thing. That's a pretense too. They're still all about trying to get a particular result, okay, over nature, so to speak. You know, some dynamic that gets a powerful result, and that power, you know, is what they're aiming for, of a result. You know, the rocket, you know, shoots up through the atmosphere and gets into orbit. That's the idea. It's like we accomplished this success. Whereas the women say, no, we don't, we're not trying to accomplish some success, we're just trying to please everything, you know, please both truth and lies. We're managing this third option of pleasing both truth and lies, and both sides of the conflict can be happy, that kind of thing. That's the female energy. Okay, and again, both are totally delusional, 100% delusional. But they each pretend like they're really going to please the other side, but that's just a front, that's just a facade. The dharmic mentality is the only one that works, which is steady determination, no excuses. You don't take a day off, say, oh, I want to excuse myself. That's non-dharmic, because if you take your attention off no excuses, where else can your attention go but to excuses? There's nowhere else it can go. Either we believe we cannot excuse ourselves from reality, or we believe we can. So in terms of belief, there's nowhere else to go. If we say, I'm going to take some time off from believing there's no excuses, by default, there's nowhere else to go. We're already in believing we can excuse ourselves from reality, which is impossible. There's nowhere to excuse ourselves to. Then we claim there's an abyss. No, there's no abyss. The whole idea of saying we can excuse ourselves from reality, that brings up the whole belief in an abyss. Because we say, well, we're not aware of any place to go, but we want to leave reality, so there must be some place, but it's like nothingness. You know, we can just go into this abyss. No, there's no abyss. There's just imaginary. There's an imaginary, we can imagine abyss, but it's all still in the mind. It hasn't left the mind at all. There's no abyss. There's no abyss at all. Then we try to say, well, there's a little abyss. You know, the female energy say, well, you can have a little abyss. And the man says, we must defeat the abyss. You know, the woman says, no, we must learn to live with the abyss. We can learn to live with the abyss. The answer is there is no abyss. Dharmically, there's no abyss. There's no abyss to defeat, and there's no abyss to manage. So this kind of talk is not welcome in the world at this point. Because at this point of great uncertainty, people are still thinking, I got one last chance to see if I can deify, you know, incertitude, doubt and certainty, doubt, if I can deify doubt. And so right now, nobody's listening. Almost no one is listening, actually. It's very, very slim now. The mood is not there. It's just like music styles. Everybody says they like music, but I've never seen more conflict in the world than people who say they love music. People say, we're all music lovers. Music will bring the world together. If you want to create conflict in the world, just try to bring everybody together through music. That's the worst thing there is. Because I've experienced this my whole life. Nothing gets people more angry than somebody else, than arguments over music. Because why? We all love different styles. So if you want to start a fight, start arguing about music. And yet we all claim that music will bring the world together. It's the common denominator. No, it isn't. Because we all have very different styles. Some people just say, oh, it's jazz. Jazz is the best. But I just love jazz. Or some people say, it's opera. No, opera, I can't live without it. The other stuff, no way. It's terrible. I really don't like it that much. And then they're told to say, no, I can manage the whole thing. I really like it all. That's not true. It's not really true. Really, do you love rap music? Oh, yeah, I love rap music. And I love, do you love, you know, vocal rasp? You love, you know, speed metal and stuff. Well, for me, I can, you know, honestly, I don't love it all as much. Not equally. No way. Like, I love I listen to the Beach Boys. I find their music is the best for me. And other stuff is good, yeah. But you can't believe, even people at the Beach Boys, they argue like crazy over certain stuff. So there's something in us that feels that music is the cure, but it never quite cures us. And so we're really frustrated. Like, if I just get everybody to love the same music as I have, we'll all be happy because this is what's supposed to make me happy. And so they're unhappy because they're not listening to the music I listen to. And that's our solution. That's a non-dharmic solution. Music is a non-dharmic solution. Okay. But different styles are popular in different times. Remember the 80s, late 70s, the 80s disco, you know, and from the 60s, we were into a very different type of music. So like disco was like, what the heck is this? We hated disco. There was so much conflict over music between the styles of the late 50s, 60s, and the early 70s. There was kind of a boomer sort of thing, the style of music that we thought was just the greatest music ever. Like Jimi Hendrix, or, you know, Eric Clapton, whatever. A lot of different stuff, styles. That was the hardest stuff. But folk music, I mean, the doo-wop, and pop music, all that stuff. And then along came disco. And we were just like, get rid of this stuff. This is horrible. And so we thought people who listened to disco were just the devil, you know. I mean, to our sensibilities, they were. And it's funny now, looking back, going through a grocery store, they had this great disco music playing all this stuff. I'm saying, hey, you know what? That was really good music, actually. It was just so different that, you know, we hated it. Because it was these people thought the music we listened to was horrible. Like, we're a bunch of, you know, we're passé. This is what's cool now. Because it's really, really super danceable, right? People take drugs and dance to disco music. That's what they did. But it is very danceable. You feel like dancing. And that's the whole point of it. There was this generation of la-di-da, let's just dance to disco music. And, of course, the 60s, the boomers were all super self-righteous about let's revolution, change the world. So their music then was revolutionary, kind of, you know, very, very different, right? Designed to get people to discuss, form groups, discuss, activism. It had messages. The music of the 60s, 70s was full of, we look for messages in everything. Okay, this the music. How does this music motivate us to do what we need to do to change the world? That's the boomers' music. That's the 50s, 60s, 70s, early 70s. Then disco music was not about doing anything except dancing. Have a good time and dance. That's it. So we just thought that these people were derelict, you know. Now, I didn't quite feel that way, but the currents around me was that way, the boomers. I was into the Dharma already, so I said, you know, whatever. You know, whatever. I don't want to get caught up in that. And then from disco, you know, came you know, other styles. Okay, came other styles. And it goes on and on and on. It goes on and on and on. I was talking to a man yesterday who's like 33 or something. Or 33, he said. He was born, 87, 30. Anyway, his sister is like 10 years older. His two sisters, 10 years old, younger. 10 years younger. They're millennials. They're born like 2000, 2001, something like that. He was born prior, in the 80s, late 80s, before the internet, before smartphones, before all this stuff, okay, before virtual reality, all these things that happened. Whereas the millennials were born into the internet, smartphones, all this stuff. That's all they know. And he told me that they are like in a different universe than him. They live in a different universe, he says. The difference is so great, he says, you can't believe it. In 10 years, a little over 10 years, but that's how fast tastes change. So this message I have is dharmic, and it should span all generations, because dharma does. Truth is true. There's no conflict, and the approach to it has to be basically the same. The river is a river of bias, continuity, fear. We have to block panic in order to evaporate it, and we have to keep glimpsing that truth is true and nothing else is true, and there's no conflict in truth at all. There's no way around any of that. That's always going to be the same. But styles of presenting this can change. So I have a certain style. It's just not in vogue right now. Just like certain music, if it's not in vogue, nobody pays attention to it hardly. It's just not. How many people are really paying attention to folk music now? Or doo-wop? Not a lot. Okay, not a lot. There's little tiny pockets of people, but it's not in vogue, especially among the young people. They have their style, and you can't change their style at all. Imagine trying to change the style of young people, of their music, what they love for musically. No, they're very adamant about this is the music I love. Don't try to change me. They get very hostile if older people try to tell them. So it's the same thing with the Dharma. There may be different styles. Or it may just be the spirit of the times that we believe we can be happy with conflict, which is what I believe, is we're going through this phase where we believe we're going to be happy. There's a way to be happy with conflict, like virtual reality, man. That can make us happy with conflict. And so they're not willing to apply steady determination. So they're not dharmic. They're not willing to apply skillful means. Steady determination with skillful means is dharmic. And if you don't do that, you're not dharmic yet. Okay, you might be a probationary apprentice, but you're not dharmic. Hearing the truth and wowing it is dharmic. That's a skillful means. If you actually allow yourself to truly glimpse the truth, glimpse it and say this is true, and then blocking the panic, that's dharmic. However you glimpse the truth and then block the panic, that's skillful means. That's dharmic. But just merely reading it, you can easily be giving a false corollary, saying, well, this is dharmic. No, just reading quotes from Nisargadatta Maharaj is not necessarily dharmic in itself. It's, are you stunned by it? Do you allow yourself to feel and glimpse that this is true and nothing else is true? Then are you blocking the panic from that? So you have to have both of those there. Otherwise, you'll just stall out. And stalling out is not dharmic. Okay, it's not. That's trying to manage conflict. That's so popular right now, is that female energy of believing we can manage conflict is very, very powerful in the world right now. And there's a resurgence also of the male energy of we can triumph and gain power, but that's not as strong. That's what Trump represents, but it's not as strong. The female way of managing conflict is very powerful in the world right now, and so. That's going to blind people to the Dharma. They won't listen right now. They're not listening. This is what Longchampa told me. There's come times when people are simply not willing to listen. We're not willing to listen. We're not willing to be dharmic, which means to apply skillful means. Okay, to evaporating continuity fear, evaporating bias, evaporating the familiarity problem. And so if they're not willing, there's nothing you can do. Longchampa said there's nothing you can do except retreat and wait until they've calmed down, settled down. Because when they're in panic mode, they can't listen. They can't be steady. So what's going to happen in the world is attempt to panic the world. And at that point, they won't be able to listen to the Dharma. So Longchamp advises, retreat to the wild woods. Go and retreat. Stay calm. And when they settle down, then, we can we can have tea and talk about it, right? And to say, okay, skillful means, right? Steady, skillful means. And then they maybe say, okay, yeah, I got to do this. I have no choice. So this is where we're at right now. So I'm going to, you know, retreat. Dharma Kings will arrange some sort of retreat for me. I don't know what it will be. And I'm not going to be in any, you know, looking for some sort of special relationship in terms of, you know, let's see if this works. Let's blend styles, or let's practice style of managing conflict or triumphing over conflict. I'm not going to do that either. I'll just be sort of incognito, go into incognito mode, so to speak. Yeah. And retreat to the wild woods, be incognito, and wait until the styles change. Musical styles change. They can change quite rapidly, actually. And styles, people may get so desperate, they realize, hey, you know, I really have to apply myself now. I'm ready to really listen and do it. And until you reach that, you know, then you're not dharmic yet, until you reach the point where you realize you have no choice. I became dharmic when I realized I had no choice. There's no choice. And I experienced, we can never learn to manage conflict or learn to be happy with conflict or triumph over. It's impossible. It's impossible. Because it's imaginary and doesn't really exist in the first place. Right? So trying to manage what doesn't exist itself is an imaginary conflict, isn't it? So I had no choice. And then I realized, okay, I just have to get down to work, and that's it. So then I became dharmic. On the path, dharmic, skillful means. Started using skillful means as a steady determination. So when there are those in the world who are ready for that, who are really willing to do that, then we'll see. We'll work on that bridge, you know, when we get to it. That's pretty simple. Okay. And so I don't know how my days will go. I really don't know. But it's a time of action right now in terms of, you know, do what needs to be done to get yourself into refuge, right protection. Then those dogs of panic, those vicious dogs, the hounds of hell, won't be able to rattle your cage at all. All right, very great. That's it for this one.